Hi, this is Joel Rosenberg, founder and editor-in-chief of All Israel News and our sister site, All Arab News. I'm really pleased to be able to welcome onto the program today David Makovsky, who is an expert on U.S.-Israel relations, on Israeli leadership, and on the broader relationship between the United States, Israel, and the Arab and Muslim world. He is the author of a book that I absolutely love and devoured this past year, Be Strong and of Good Courage. He wrote this with former Ambassador Dennis Ross, and we'll have a link to the book on Amazon on our site. This is a book that deals with four of Israel's premiers, four Israeli prime ministers who really shaped the direction of the country. And David and Dennis bring just extraordinary insights and anecdotes, and you really see the leadership decisions at critical points. David also is the host of a podcast that is my favorite podcast now. It's called Decision Points. And again, you'll see a link and a screenshot of it. This is a series of roughly 30-minute programs dealing with key moments of Israeli, American, and often Arab decision-making with David's history and analysis, but then his interviews with some of the key players in those moments. And I have absolutely loved them, and I look forward to both of those conversations. But today I'm going to ask David to talk about Joe Biden, because I think the number one question that people who love Israel are asking is, what will the change from the Trump years, tumultuous as they've been, to the Biden and Harris administration? What would that look like? And David works at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. He has served in U.S. government positions, including as an advisor for Secretary of State John Kerry. So, David, thank you so much for being with All Israel News. And I'd love your take on, who is Joe Biden? What should we know about?
Thank you very much, Joel, first of all, for hosting me. It's an honor for me to be with you today. Look, I think to understand Biden, you have to understand his deep emotional attachment to Israel. His first foreign trip he took, he was a young senator from Delaware. His wife tragically dies. He's 29 years old, and he lost a child too. And he goes to Egypt and to Israel, and he meets with Golda Meir. And it's hard for maybe our viewers today of 2020 to realize what that was like. There was constant tension going on between Egypt and Israel. There had been a war of attrition along the Suez Canal. The Six-Day War now seems like a great triumph, of course, but the idea of the war was coming back was very, very tangible, and indeed it did. You know, the 73 war called the Yom Kippur War, the October War, happened at that time. And Golda Meir gives him this briefing. And the more maps she unfurls and the more detail she gets into, the more he becomes ashen face. I've heard this story. I've been in the audience. I've heard it many times. But he tells it with such strength and real depth. And finally, he's looking to her for reassurance because the situation looks so grim. And she says, "Senator, like, don't worry. It's going to be okay, Senator." And he like takes a breath. And she said, "Why?" He said, "After all you just told me." And she said, "Because we have a secret weapon, Senator." And he said, "The secret weapon, can you tell me?" And she said, "Yes, our secret weapon is we have nowhere else to go." So the idea of Biden, who, lived actually at the time of the Holocaust, he brings his grandchildren to on their first foreign trip to see Dachau, I believe. And, the sense of Israel living in existential danger is something that I think is very much part of Biden's world, coming from that generation. I should say that there's no leader in Israel today that could talk about conversations with Golda Meir. Bibi Netanyahu and others were not political players in 1973. Right. But Biden, as he tells the story, I think that story for me illuminates this sense of him contextualizing Israel's existence in a very difficult region, very challenging. And I think that will animate him. I talked to my co-author, Dennis Ross, and who says a lot, and he said this publicly, that Biden was his number one ally in some of the battles he fought inside the previous Democratic administration. So I think he's someone who really gets Israel it's visceral in a way. Part of the critique that some of the Israelis have of Obama was that everything with him was cerebral. And the Israelis tend to connect with people who have that, who could demonstrate that almost visceral love of the country. And I think Biden very much fits that bill.
Well, that's interesting because I think you're right. One of the contrasts, setting aside policy for a moment, Obama just had a very, tense, it wasn't just prickly. I mean, it was a train wreck, the relationship between Obama and Netanyahu. Biden has always had warmer relationships. That's part of just who he is. He's got this blue-collar Scranton, charm that is part of his political success. And I think that, but press that or test that against people whose concerns, let's say the former Secretary of Defense, right, Robert Gates. Look, couldn't love Biden more, nicest guy in the world, but Gates says he's been wrong on every foreign policy issue for the last 40 years. Now, that's not really true, and it's not really entirely fair, but it tells us there have been a lot of things that at least Gates and he have disagreed with that have been significant in the Middle East. So how should people be thinking about Biden from a policy and relationship standpoint?
Well, look, let's take Iran, for example, because that's very much in the minds of people who care about Israel. I think it's clear that everyone is going to be learning lessons, I hope, from the JCPOA. And while I think President-elect Biden is talking about returning to the Iran nuclear deal, he's put forward a lot of conditions which are not going to be easily met. He said the Iranians have to come back into compliance. That means they have to ship out 2,100 kilo of low-enriched uranium. It's the uranium is the main measurable element here, and they've been in violation. Now, of course, they say, "Well, the U.S. left first," and they point fingers. I get that, but coming back into compliance is not going to be easy. And I think it's clear that also when Biden says to lengthen and strengthen it, what him and Tony Blinken, who's now going to be the Secretary of State, assuming he's confirmed, is saying the sunset provisions. The sunset provisions are crucial. It's one of Israel's main critiques. And that is, 13 years is a blink of an eye here in history. And we're already halfway through it because the deal was signed, in 2015. We're almost halfway through it. So when he says lengthen the sunset, he's saying is that the restrictions on uranium nuclear enrichment have to go way beyond what they are now. And so this, to me, does not sound like somebody who is robotically just kind of repeating talking points, but someone who say, hey, we got to learn. And I think he's also made points about the proxies. Could you see a dimension here of, Iran, by its support of the Houthis and the Hezbollah, how could you monitor limitations on their export of missiles and rockets to the proxies? So I think I give Biden and his team, who I think highly of, Tony Blinken, the Secretary of State, Jake Sullivan at the NSC, these are two centrists. These are two very experienced people who kind of see the world as it is and not just as they want it to be. And I tend to think that there's going to be some lessons learned on Iran. So I think that's a big one. The second one is on the Arab states. And I was very happy that when he was in the campaign, he really endorsed it without reservations, the Abraham Accords. Yes. That was really important. I mean, Biden and Trump couldn't always even agree if it was light outside or dark outside, but they agreed on the Abraham Accords. That's important. And that gives me hope that it will be built upon as a foundation to deal with some of the other states that might not, you know, that might not be easy, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Oman, et cetera. But this is an amazing moment in the Middle East, that what you're really seeing is that Arab states that had deferred their own bilateral interests with Israel for 18 years, really 70 years, if you want to go back to the state of Israel, but certainly since the Arab Peace Initiative, to say, okay, we're not going to do anything with Israel until they give the Palestinians all that they want. Right. And now these the wealthiest states are now saying, no, you know, we have a convergence because we're worried of the U.S. pulling back, retrenching from the Middle East, mm-hmm. and who's going to be there for us to deal with Iran and other threats, destabilizing forces. That's Israel. So, and also the economics of the capital from the Gulf and the Israeli technological entrepreneurial spirit is like almost a merger between Google and Microsoft. I mean, it's an unbelievable connection between the countries that are the most, you know, globally focused, free market focused. And I think that that is a good sign. And I think, I believe the, you know, Biden, when he says that this is something I want. So I hope he builds on it. And I hope it's a way of telling the Palestinians, hey, man, the train's leaving the station. You've got to jump on board. And I hope that this, the you know, if you say, how will he do it a little differently than the Abraham Accords? Will he try to have a tie-in and get the Palestinians to, you know, every step that the Arabs take towards Israel, Israel takes a step towards the Palestinians, but the Palestinians have to take a step towards Israel too. Yeah. So I tend to think that this is a good new development. It's the best news out of the Middle East in 2020, which admittedly is been a rotten year, but on the Middle East, this is a historic moment. And I think the vice president, and it was now the president-elect, will build on it. He'll want to restore the ties with the Palestinians because of the boycott that's existed. And the Palestinians know what have to do. They know they're going to do things too. That's why they renewed the security cooperation. You know, and there's all these rumors that they're going to change their rules on martyr payments and things like that. Right. We'll see. But if they don't do their part, a lot of the things that the U.S. wants to do, and what, you know, will be stymied today, because this, a lot of these are congressional decisions about restoring funding and things like that. So I hope there's a package deal here that is going to be good for all. I don't think, I'll just end with this, I don't think we could, you know, extrapolate from this idea of trying to restore ties as now meaning, okay, so now we're going to have a fifth home run ball, that you're going to swing for the fences a fifth time. I don't see it right now because I think the Venn diagram between the leaders, Netanyahu and Abbas, don't overlap. I think U.S. has got a lot of other issues. We have to deal with COVID, and its aftermath. I don't see swinging for the home run, but I could see some singles and doubles here that could happen, and they use the baseball parlance, that could end the impasse, that could be good for everyone. But the new dynamic is the Arab states. And I see this as a very important move going forward.
In the last 30 seconds, what would be your biggest concern, something that we should be watching for as Biden comes into power with his team? What's something that maybe concerns you?
I guess what concerns me is that the Palestinians do not, you know, make another mistake and overestimate, you know, oh, Biden will do all this for us and we just have to sit back and do nothing. That's not going to happen. It's just not. And this is not someone who's going to just say, okay, let's pick up where we left off and you know, it's
not going to happen. All right. So that's, you just said something, so I got to add 30 seconds more. Do you see Biden as specifically not, that he'll be intentional about not being Obama? You know, being a deputy means that you sort of support everything, but it doesn't necessarily show us what he thinks. And of course, the world has changed in 4 years.
Right. I think that's the point, is that he's, you know, he's his own person and the world has changed in 4 years. And so I think that is the key. He's going to have a different tone. And I think the, you know, things got off on a bad foot and never really recovered, as you point out. And I think in this case, you know, Biden's, it's going to be very hard to marginalize him in any way, because his love for Israel is on his sleeve. and the people in that part of the world want to kind of know where you stand. Now, I think because he has, you know, love for Israel doesn't mean he doesn't want dignity for the Palestinians. He clearly does. And I think we all do. And I think, you know, that's why this impasse is so terrible. So I think, though, that he'll be someone who can invoke his long record of decades, and people will know this is where his heart is. Yeah. And I think that's important. And so I see it as different. I see the Middle East is different. And I think that Palestinians thought of, if they could hold up the train in the past and no one's going to move without them, maybe, you know, in the last administration, last Democratic administration, that won't be true now. So I think the combination of Biden being his own person and the Middle East in, you know, at a time of change, those are two factors that make me think it's not just, you know, a return to what was.
Well, I hope you're right. And I would say I am concerned about the Palestinian dynamic. I'm more concerned about Iran deciding to test Biden and wondering, like having no idea how Biden would handle that type of resistance. But that will have to be a podcast for another day. Clearly, you have a lot of episodes of Decision Points coming up. David Makovsky, thank you so much for joining us on All Israel News.
Delighted to be with you, Joel. Thank you for having me.